No school assembly ever went that quiet that quickly, I suspect. On behalf of Jean's family, I welcome you here today to this service celebration of thanksgiving for her life and service. And at this point, let me say thank you from all of us, but also from the family to St. Margaret's School for their hospitality for this special time together. My name is Tony Floyd, and Back in the day, I was minister at St. Andrew's Uniting Church here at Berwick, which is where I first got to know Jean and Ken and the family. And with me today is our current minister, the Reverend Wendy Snook, who will share with me in this service. We're here to give thanks to God for the life and service of Jean Heriot, her gentle death in faith, and to affirm the Christian conviction that while death is the end of mortal life, it marks a new beginning in our relationship with God. We're also here to share stories, and there'll be laughter among those, and some of the laughter ones even will bring tears. But we offer to one another our love and our support. As we gather in community and hope, I greet you in the name of God. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die." Jesus also said, "Come to me, all who are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest." For the beauty of the earth. Thank you.
Come in. Thank you, choir. That was beautiful. Let us pray. Eternal God, our Heavenly Father, your love for us is everlasting. You alone can turn the shadow of death into the brightness of the morning light. We come before you now in our need of comfort. On this day of parting, do not abandon Jean, whom we love, and do not desert us in our grief, but come and be with us. Give us courage and strength for today, and hope and peace for tomorrow. Speak to us now through your holy word, that our faith may be strengthened and our hope sustained. Through Jesus Christ our Lord we pray. Amen.
This service in which we share today itself speaks of Jean's loves in life and ministry. First of all, it's Christian worship. It's filled with the memories of the God she served with joy and faithfulness, music and singing, which so characterised her life, relationships, service and ministry. The Bible and prayer, which supported and nourished each day of her life, from morning to sleeping. Those sharing in this time of thanksgiving themselves represent much that was significant about Jean's life and person. The central place of her extended family through children and grandchildren. Reflections on her life with, for, and through them. Jean's strong commitment to the church, its life, music, and singing. And all of you who share this service bear witness to the diversity of peoples and influences across the community, both by Jean and on Jean, her life, service, and ministry. As a writer long ago said, for everything there is a season, and a time, and a purpose for everything under heaven. So in this time, now it is time to give back to God the life we have treasured and in which we have delighted. Now is the time to receive from God the promised comfort, peace, and strength to journey on. Now is a time to celebrate, a time to give thanks. So I invite you into a short period of silence for your own reflections, and then the choir will lead us in evening song. So let us be silent with our own recollections.
I'd like to personally acknowledge Karen Fitzharris, who's made repeated visits to St. Margaret's to ensure the audio-visual systems of this auditorium were understood and working for today's service. All this as she deals with her own mother's ill health. Talking at funerals can be a bit like preaching to the converted. Everyone here knew Jean in some way, as a friend, a teacher, a colleague, a wonderful, loving, kind-spirited and caring woman. But to me, she was Mum. Mum had so many strengths. In life, she overcame a lot of adversity, personal tragedies and disappointments, but she carried on regardless. Mum's life story is inspirational, and her love of life and people is well known. She was a lover of all creatures, great and small. Once, I was discussing incremental change with Mum, how a good situation can gradually get worse over time without you noticing. It reminded me of the film clip I saw in Year 11 Science about the boiled frog experiment. So I was telling Mum, if you place a frog in a beaker of water that's too warm, the frog will swim around frantically trying to escape. But if you place the frog in water that's comfortable and gradually raise the temperature, the frog will happily swim around until... I had to stop there. The look of horror on Mum's face. The concern for the poor little frog. No, no, Mum, the frog was okay, I lied. Not much more than a week ago, Mum was talking to me and she said, "You were a good violinist." "Not concert standard." I nearly fell off my chair, I was laughing so hard. Dame Edna Everidge couldn't have said it better. Hatches, matches, dispatches, well, not quite, but divorces, new partners, stepchildren, she welcomed them all and loved the exes too. My stepdaughter Brianna was a student at ICA College at one stage, and Jean's cottage being just over the fence was a convenient pickup point. Mum would put out enough afternoon tea for five people, and Brianna tried, but it just wasn't possible to eat that much. Her younger brother Oscar wasn't a hug anyone type of guy, but Mum kept working on him until he cracked. It might have been their love of animals in general that did it, but I suspect their shared love of Delilah was the cause. Her afternoon teas were wonderful, but Mum was no barista. Always hospitable, Mum liked to go the extra mile to make things special. I haven't forgotten Mum's introduction to plunger coffee. Weak and watery, it was truly horrible. And until a lack of coffee in the plunger was identified as the cause, I always asked for instant if given a choice. Mum used to buy my favourite brand of instant coffee. Even then, I sometimes still got hideous covers. There was the time Mum switched dishwashing liquids to an ultra concentrate and let the cups air dry in the dish rack. Mmm, delicious. One afternoon, I was persevering with a particularly bad coffee when I noticed three or four brown star-shaped lumps swimming in the bottom of the cup. "Mum, what's that?" I said. "Oh," Mum said, "there was an accident with the coffee and the dog kibble. I thought Kirsty had picked it all out." In fairness to Mum, I also had countless cups of coffee that were good. Not barista quality, but good. It's all beside the point, really, because the coffee, the afternoon teas, the hospitality, that's not the reason I visited. Just like it was for all of you, visiting Mum was an opportunity to spend time with a wonderful, loving, kind individual whose love of life, people, music, children, and little hearing dogs was contagious. Goodbye, Mum, and thank you for everything. You'll be sorely missed.
Thank you. Hi everybody, I'm Zoe, one of Jean's many grandchildren, and I'd like to say a few words. And today I'm going to be speaking on behalf of myself and my three younger brothers, Lockie, Callum and Angus. Nanny was a friend to so many, a role model and a truly inspirational woman to the many that had the pleasure of knowing her. I think it's truly rare to find a person like our Nanny, to find someone who accepted you for who you are and saw the good in everybody and everything. She was a person who thought about others first. I can honestly say that I've never heard her utter a bad word about anybody, and the only times I can remember her getting frustrated was when she said, "Oh, for heaven's sake," oh, she'd run her wheelchair into the wall for the 10th time that day. Some of the fondest memories we have of our Nanny was when we were younger and going over to stay the nights on the weekend. These days always entailed making a batch of shortbread, a game of Chinese checkers, and taking Monty or Delilah for a walk. To anyone who was lucky enough to sample her incredible baking, they will know how hard it was to stop at just one shortbread or yo-yo. Even after five or so, they were still pretty hard to resist. I've been making shortbread and baking all sorts of goodies with Nanny for as long as I can remember. Even though in my young years, my version of helping consisted of sitting on the floor and eating the remaining batter out of the mixing bowl. I remember her fussing over me, telling me how she'd be in trouble should I spoil my dinner. My brothers and I were trying to think about what to write, and one of the first things on all of our lists were her afternoon teas that we had with her every Thursday. My youngest brother, Angus, is sure that we've had thousands of afternoon teas at the cottage. Every Thursday after school, we headed over to Nanny's. And for all of us, this is our favourite part of the week. The way Nanny fussed over us would make anyone think that royalty was coming over to visit. Our afternoon teas usually consisted of soft drink, chips, biscuits, cheese, and of course shortbread. I'm sure you can see why we all love them so much. When we were smaller, Nanny would have everything laid out and ready for us, but as we got older, we would come over and set everything up with a watchful voice, telling us where everything went and to make sure we brought out the right flavoured chips for this week. Nanny would go around the table and ask us about our days and how our week had been since we'd seen her last. We would each tell her about school, our friends, and any small thing that she might like to hear about. As we got older, like many teenagers, I sometimes felt like I couldn't tell my grandparents much about my personal life. But no matter what I had to say, Nanny was there, ready to listen to me. She never judged me. I never felt awkward or uncomfortable. No matter what, there was just something about her that could uplift me. If I went there feeling sad or just not even my best, I would always leave feeling happy, blessed, and loved. This is just the gift that my Nanny had. My Nanny was so special because she had the gift of loving other people unconditionally. I'd just like to finish by saying something written by Nan Whitcomb that my dad said at my grandpa Ken's funeral. To mourn too long for those we love is self-indulgent, but to honour their memory with a promise to live better for having known them gives purpose to their life and some meaning for their death. This has resonated with me so much because my Nanny has had such an impact on my life and how I look at it. She could have been bitter or sad for every obstacle that she endured with her health that ultimately led to her being bound to a wheelchair. But she didn't let that stop her from being a gracious, loving, and inspirational person. I hope I can live my life the same way that she did. I'm going to miss you so much, Nanny, far more than words can express. The world was a better place with you, and we are all better for having known you.
Glasses, Dad always told me they were very handy, because I can't really see without them now. As we can all see today, Mum knows too many people, so for me to thank all of you would be very, very hard. I know from experience going shopping with her, it was just out of control. It wasn't shopping, it was more of a social visit. Mum! Anyway, she was a pretty good old dear duck. Mum was pretty special to me. But I'm pretty much here to thank the whole 20 years spent in this beautiful, picturesque place was always accompanied by two people, Graham and Angela Jones. People, and to say without them, none of this could have, would have happened. Actually, they were more than just great friends, Angela being Mum's best mate, by the way. They were also her carers, super carers. Because of their great modesty, and Essendon, great being an Essendon supporter, of course, obviously, they may feel quite self-conscious being mentioned here today, but the reality is that it would not be proper of me not to acknowledge the immense and vital role Graham and Angela Jones played in making Mum's final 20 years very secure, happy and full of joy. The Heriot family will forever be in your debt. From all of Mum's kids and grandkids, we love you with all our hearts. Thank you very much. To end, Mum always said to me I was special because you and Dad chose me. I'm not feeling so special today. I miss you already. Love, Stephen, Matt, Lisa and Jane. If we could all give Graham and Angela a round of applause, I'd really appreciate it. And if we could sort of hurry it up, the test is on, so I've got to get back for the cricket. Thanks, Tony. I did it, mate.
You did, yes.
My mum was a woman of amazing compassion. Her love for music inspired people, and I believe her superpower was to make her friends, acquaintances, students and colleagues all feel loved and a part of the family, and that shows today. While I have many musical memories of Mum, for me it was her love of animals that I seem to have inherited. As children, we always had pets. There was the mice, the guinea pigs, the dogs, the cats, and for me there was a pony who lived in the backyard at the manse for a while. The stories of Mum riding the tan and jumping park benches led to a day where as a teenager I was able to convince Mum to get on my pony Shorty. I was amazed at how easily she could get on using the front steps at Bride Avenue. Alas, the getting off was a little more problematic. As Mum leaned forward, Shorty put his head down and Jean rolled over his shoulder and found herself sitting on the ground. It was most undignified. Mum took this in her stride. I'm sure she thought she covered it up, but I know that she bruised her posterior. The list of animals in Mum's life started with Trixie and her puppies when she was a child, and it continued in her married life with Bazzy the black poodle, one and two, Joseph Jacob, the ginger cat that was rescued by Shirley Jacobs, the folk singer, and he used to hide under the kitchen table and swipe at your legs as you went past. He was then followed by Ricky the dog, whose escapism and destructive habits kept us all entertained. Kari and Ambi, not to mention Rocky, or as Dad called him, the grotesque quadruped. And of course, her hearing dog Monty, followed by Delilah, who's here today. There were a couple more cats and the occasional stray dog in there as well, and Mum had a place in her heart for all of them. She never failed to ask after my animals, even though Seedy bit her once. While I'm sure there was times I was a source of exasperation and stress to Mum, my taking up motorcycle riding was a huge challenge for her. She always tried to maintain a strong tie with me. I remember her signing one of her famous letters to me with the paragraph, "May the road rise up to meet you and the wind always be at your back," which is pretty much a biker's prayer. Mum's final days in the cottage were filled with love, surrounded by family and friends, watching Miss Marple episodes and Inspector Morse, and even the odd episode of Hard Quiz on the ABC. I will be forever grateful for those weeks and to Kirsty and Ewan who made it possible for her to come home.
I miss you, Mum.
I'm honoured to have been asked by Jean's family to say a few words today about Jean's professional life, her approach to her professional life, her professional achievements, the recognition she had been given for these achievements, and finally her legacy. Jean approached her work with boundless enthusiasm, seemingly endless and sometimes exhausting energy, fierce determination, and great passion for her work, students and colleagues. She was a lifelong learner and always wanted to know how to do things better. She was committed to improving her own musical and teaching skills so that she could help her students become better musicians. She believed that everything was possible and encouraged those around her to fulfil their potential. Central to Jean's teaching philosophy was a genuine love and care for her students as individuals. She always made time for those who needed extra attention or had problems to solve. From my time at St.Margarets, I remember a new Year 7 student who came to Jean in tears after the first choir rehearsal of the year, terribly upset that she didn't seem to be able to sing in tune. Jean was not fazed and did not avoid the issue by suggesting that maybe the child should take up hockey instead. She said, "My office, every morning at 8 o'clock, until we get you sorted." She did indeed get her sorted, and that child has gone on to become an outstanding music educator and conductor. Another vivid memory from St. Margaret's was the look of grim determination that would descend on Jean before she went off to do battle with Joan Butler or Virginia Henry in the principal's office. She would have a list of things that she wanted for the music department, and she was prepared to fight to secure the resources she needed to fulfil her goals. And although she didn't win every battle, she was able to convince her leaders of the value of her quest with incredible results. Things were not always smooth sailing for Jean, and along the way there would be challenges and setbacks, both personal and professional. But they only caused her to pause, regroup, and push ahead, confident that she would find another way forward. And usually she did. Jean's greatest achievements in her professional life stemmed from her discovery of Kodai teaching techniques in the mid-1970s. As far as I can recall, Jean's first exposure to Kodai teaching was at an Australian String Teachers Association conference, where she heard young violinists singing, playing, and reading music in new and exciting ways. She loved the ways the students were engaged in their learning, having fun, and achieving great results. And this set her off on her journey to learn more about Kodai teaching. With the support of Ken Lyle, her principal at Strathcona, where she was teaching, Jean successfully applied for a Churchill Fellowship in 1977 to study Kodai teaching in Hungary. This was a very brave thing to do in many ways. As a minister's wife and mother of 5 children, taking off to Europe for a few months was not something you did lightly and something that required much planning and support. And although a skilled teacher, Jean did not have tertiary music training, and she knew she would have to work very hard to get her musical skills to the level required. Furthermore, Hungary was still a communist country behind the Iron Curtain, and communication with the Liszt Academy was far from easy. But Jean took these challenges in her stride and left Australia determined to learn as much as she could. Of course, as always with Jean, there were plenty of laughs along the way. On one occasion, Jean had learned a new Hungarian greeting to be used in the kindergarten. She thought she'd try out her new language skills by loudly greeting the driver of the public bus the next morning in the same way. When the whole bus collapsed into laughter, it was pointed out that she had got it a bit wrong and had asked the bus driver to come to bed with her. I think she said no. On her return from Hungary, Jean was determined to make the most of the opportunity given to her, and Strathcona became a hub of Kodai teaching, with regular international visitors, observers from across Australia, and many professional learning workshops held at Featherstone Hall. At the same time, Jean linked up with other pioneers of the Kodai movement in Victoria and across Australia, being part of the establishment of the Kodai Association at both national and state levels. Jean was a frequent presenter for the Kodai Association and influenced many teachers through the workshops and courses she ran for Kamiya for many years from this time. In 1979, Jean was invited to bring her Strathcona Choir to Sydney to sing at the first International Kodai Symposium in Australia. This was a big honour and a great recognition of Jean's work at that time. Jean's passion for and championing of Kodai teaching and quality music education continued in her next role as Director of Music at St. Margaret's School. She gathered a great team around her and established a model Kodai classroom program, as well as instrument choirs and instrumental ensembles. Many came to St. Margaret's to observe the Kodai program in action, and many overseas experts came to the school to work with the classes and ensembles. I remember as a young teacher being both terrified and exhilarated when the very famous Cotty Foray came to St. Margaret's and taught my grade 2 class in a demonstration session. Fortunately, they sang in tune. Some of them might be here. In 1986, Jean formed the Berwick Children's Choir to provide opportunities for quality music education and choral performance to those in the Berwick community outside St. Margaret's. The choir was, of course, a great success, undertaking major international tours, producing recordings, and providing a quality music education for many young people. The choir continues today as Melbourne Youth Chorale. Jean's work has been recognised by many. She is an honorary life member of both the Kodai Association, Kamiya, and the Australian Society for Music Education. Kamiya has a professional learning bursary named after Jean. Her potential was recognised by the Churchill Trust and her being awarded a Churchill Fellowship in 1977. What a great return they got on their investment in Jean. Jean was named City of Casey Citizen of the Year in 1998 and was awarded the Order of Australia Medal in 2006. The Harriet McManus School that we are gathered in is a lasting tribute to Jean's impact on music at St. Margaret's. And so to Jean's legacy. Jean's work lives on in the careers of all the students and colleagues she inspired. On a personal note, Jean completely changed my professional life. When I first met Jean, I was heading for an academic career. And in one of the first conversations I ever had with Jean, I let her know there was no way I ever wanted to teach music to kids. Jean had other plans. And it didn't take long for her to introduce me to the joys of Kodai teaching at both primary and secondary levels. My master's thesis into Kodai-based flute teaching came directly out of my work with Jean at St. Margaret's. Jean also introduced me to the world of children's choirs and was instrumental in my being awarded a Churchill Fellowship to study outstanding children's choirs around the world. And it was Jean's support and encouragement that led me to start Young Voices of Melbourne just 4 years after Jean had started the Berwick Children's Choir. I recently watched a rather corny Christmas movie called It's a Wonderful Life. In this movie, the hero is feeling dejected as he feels his life has not been important. So God sends an angel down to offer him some support and encouragement. The angel helps him to see what his town would have been like if he had never been born. And this made me think of Jean and the reach of her influence. Imagine if Jean had never been with us. There would be no Berwick Children's Choir, Berwick Youth Choir, Melbourne Youth Chorale, no Da Capo Singers, and no DCAF. There'd certainly be no Young Voices of Melbourne. There'd be no Coco's Lunch, as founder Sue Johnson would not have started her singing with Jean in the little church choir in Oakley. Kodai music education might never have taken off in Victoria, and many great school programs across Melbourne would not exist. But fortunately, we did have Jean among us, and those of us who were privileged to work or study with her will always count our blessings and be glad that we could be part of the exciting and nurturing world that she created around her.
Mark, I remember those conversations with Jean when you first started at St. Margaret's, and we both decided we were going to get you hooked, so it was a good plan. My name's Marion Stafford, and I was at Strathcona when Jean first came back from Keshkemet and started using all these funny hand signs and singing in solfège. She was an amazing lady. She completely transformed our music school at that time. I just love that smile. Just take a minute to look at that. Just etch that in your memory, because that smile has given me strength on so, so many occasions. And I think possibly for most of us, and definitely those of us who are singing today, Jean has been our musical mum. And I want to acknowledge Kirsty and Peter and Ewan and Lisa and Steve for sharing their mum with us. I know what that was like. I know the many times she wasn't home when you needed her. But what a legacy you've been part of too. So thank you for that. Jean always called me her little sister. And I spent quite a lot of time in the music office at Strathcona when things weren't going so well. I wonder how many of us have sat on Jean's knee just for a cuddle. She had amazing capacity to believe in people, to build them up, to give them a sense of direction. For me, I wasn't really anything special at school. I played the piano. I did it quite well. I worked really hard at it. But Jean made me believe in myself enough to get to uni, enough to pursue a music degree, and enough to get into the classroom and do exactly what she'd been doing at Strathcona. I think the big thing for us to remember about Jean, all of us who teach children, all of us who've been parents and mothers who've sung to our children, is that love comes first. That with love, great things can be achieved. Look at that smile again. It's full of it. And we never know how far reaching that will go. Thanks, Jean. I'm sorry I didn't get to see you last week. I actually had it on my to-do list, but I just missed out. But I know you'd say, I forgive you, little sister, and I still love you. Thanks, Jean.
One feels rather inadequate following some of those things, but also appreciative of the memories, my own, that were stirred by them. There are two other brief reflections to share. Firstly, this is from the Reverend Inika Giles, who is in hospital at the minute, and she sent this message last night. While lying in my hospital bed thinking about how I might share my experience of Jean, I thought to myself, it has to begin with a song. I'm not going to sing it, it's okay. What better song than one from The Sound of Music How do you solve a problem like Jean Heriot? How do you catch a cloud and pin it down? How do you find the word that means Jean? What a privilege to have known Jean for close on 30 years. A most gifted musician, teacher, wife, mother, grandmother, and friend. Caring, loving, adored children and they her. Mentor, fun-loving, with a huge sense of humour. We picked her up for church one morning, and as we were getting her out of the car, we couldn't hold her anymore and ended up having to sit her on the concrete. We laughed, she laughed, we all laughed. School concert at Blackwood Hall, she thought she would make an effort and have her hair done. It turned out pumpkin orange. She must have used the same dye as my sister used once. Best choir leader I have witnessed. We've eaten together, coffeed and sung. Jean was inspirational, always had time for others, never grizzled about her health. Adored Monty. Inika was one dog behind. Sorry, Delilah. Always time for a call or a note. Ken adored her and was always so proud of her. Most of all, she was a long life witness to what it means to be a follower of Christ. She was a light of Christ to all who knew her. Thank you, Jean, for the gift you were to all. We love you, and you are now in the presence of the one whom you have served so faithfully, Tom, Kathy, Paulie, and Innie. And a brief word from St. Andrews.
I didn't know Jean for very long. I've been here for a year, but I'm standing here to give thanks to God for the friendships and the faithful prayer life that Jean gave in the life of St. Andrew's Berwick Uniting Church. She was dearly loved. I know when I told others of the news of her passing, there were tears all over the place, and it was right the day before Christmas. You know, some of them learnt about this. She was a very, very special lady. One of the things I admired about her was knowing that she was a good musician, but not realising quite how good till today, in fact. She listened to our choir and was very gracious about our efforts at times, speaking as one of the singers. You know, it's one of the hard things when you're very good at something not to be critical of less perfect efforts. And she was always gracious, always encouraging, and I always felt her support as I tried myself to encourage St. Andrew's Choir. The other thing that I felt as a preacher, as some of you are aware, that Delilah was a regular churchgoer. And Delilah sometimes had a habit of getting off the wheelchair and marching up and down the aisles, greeting other people during my sermon. And I'd lose track completely of what I was saying as I'd see what Delilah was doing next. In the end, because Delilah loved Kirsty, I parked the wheelchair beside Kirsty so Delilah would hop onto her first and she could hang on to her before she went walkabout. Anyway, I'm sure that there are many memories we could all share, but I just wanted to say we're sorry that on one hand that we couldn't hold it in St. Andrew's Church itself because she's such a special person there, but we do understand and really thank so many of you for being here today. It's just awesome. I'm sure she would have been totally overwhelmed and thrilled. Yeah, thank you.
Reading from the writings of St. Paul. In which and through which it's not difficult to see the motivations that shaped Jean's life. 1 Corinthians chapter 13. If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions, if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. But as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, but when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. But when I became an adult, I put away childish things. For now we see in a mirror, dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And now faith, hope, and love abide. These three, and the greatest is love. We've heard a lot about Jean, and probably a lot more has been stirred in our own memories and reflections and thankfulness. But it's important, and it would be important to Jean, that we understand where her strength and trust came from. How was it that she was driven in such a wonderful way to the gifts and to use the gifts that she had and that she saw in others? My first memories of Jean go back to 93 when I became the minister in placement at St Andrews. It was home church for Jean and Ken. And central to those memories were the occasional times when I could sit at home and hear the singing of the children's choir as they practiced in the old hall on the site, and occasionally dropped in just to say hello. And Jean and Graham and Angela particularly seemed to be filled with energy, encouragement, smiles and warm inclusion. It was a busy, busy place. Some of you may have been among those creating the busyness. But what struck me was the energy and enthusiasm of the young people. It takes special adults with deep commitment in their hearts and well-communicated love for what they do to generate those kinds of responses and loyalties. Those are characteristics of her life and her attitude to others. But I know she would be disappointed if we did not acknowledge that they are deeply rooted in the Christian tradition and in her profound faith in God's love and compassion for all. That's the source of her strength. It's the place in which her trust is embedded. And if you took that out, it would not be the Jean Heriot that you know. I know that she had many facets to her life and service. We've heard some of them. You know more of them. She was a very proud mother and a deeply devoted wife, a carer, teacher, friend, neighbour, advisor, encourager, challenger, and on and on. With a graciousness and a consideration of others that Wendy referred to in relation to our own choir. Her life was well balanced in its centering inwards on family and those nearby, but also outwards into a wide variety of areas of community life. She was married to a minister, and that's a very important distinction from being a minister's wife. And if you want that spelled out a little more, ask my wife Shirley about that afterwards. Or Wendy, yep. They ministered together in Mildura and Oakley, Hampton Park and Hallam, and in retirement here at St Andrews. And when Ken died, she missed him enormously, but at the centre of both the good times and the almost unimaginably difficult, she knew and lived the truth that one must work the works of the one who put us on earth, and that only in action is there courage to go on. Her days were bracketed in prayer and scripture, beginning with, "Lord, help me to be the kind of person you want me to be," and ending with, "Good night, Delilah," and the 23rd Psalm. Jean's ministry was possible because both she and Ken shared a clear understanding that ministry, service, in its best and most authentic expression, is God's gift, and to be supported and not subordinated to that of one another. From that grew and flourished Jean's ministry with children and music, travels, as we've heard, with the choir. From her deep love of all her family and their growing families to her ongoing delight in the activities of children and young people here in the congregation, from the ordinary things of ministry that few except other ministers or their families can understand, to the latest struggles with faith, all formed Jean and were expressed in both her activity and strong encouragement of others in their own searching after truth for them. It's not an easy thing being a parson's kids. I don't know that, but Shirley does. And I've watched it. And I've watched it with my own kids. And it's a tough gig being a parent and letting your kids make their own journey of discovery and be their own persons. It's a brave gig as a parent doing that. And there's a lot of sore tongues from biting that are part of the journey. During Ken's final days of his journey, a phrase was used about Ken and his manner of relating to others. I heard it many times. Ken cultivated an attitude of gratitude. For me, the phrase I would use about Jean is that she nurtured a spirit of thankfulness. She nurtured a spirit of thankfulness. She reminds me of words from St. Paul. "I have learned that whatever my situation is, there to be content." A teacher, mentor of mine, wrote this poem, Reflection, which for me so fits Jean's life and times. It goes like this. "My time of history was not without significance, and my life had moments of human dignity. Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations. I had fellowship with just folk and with the greatest of spirit of times and places all over the earth. Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations. I was part of a circle of persons who believed in each other and in something together. Lord, you have been our dwelling place. I lived in a precarious world with a concern for peace on earth, goodwill to all peoples. Lord, you have been my dwelling place. Lord, you are my dwelling place." In this was Jean's faith. Through this faith in God, her life has been lived in fullness, and with the full involvement of everyone that she could. In this life in Christ, she both lived and died. And for all of those touched by this life, the challenge is this: do not try and understand her life or her enormous influence across the breadth of community by ignoring the centrality of that faith. In her, for her, and through her. To do so would be to deny how integrated her life was, for no part of it was untouched by this, and therefore no part of your life was untouched by it either. Our inheritance is thankfulness and joy. Thankfulness to Jean, who opened to us the fullness of faith in God and the use of God's gifts to her, and joy in the gifts of music and singing, which she so wondrously used, to the enrichment, to the encouragement, to the self-confidence even of many. Lord, you were and you are her dwelling place, and we praise you that she is now reunited with her beloved kin. Thanks be to God. Amen. The choir.
Thank you.
It's time now to bring our prayers before God, first for Jean, then for her family and her friends, her colleagues, her beloved students, and everyone else here from the community. Again, I thank you for coming, and let us bring our prayers before God. Gracious God, we thank you that you received Jean by baptism and blessed her with the Holy Spirit, drawing her not only into the family of your church here on earth, but into the eternal family. We ask and thank that you gave her the gift of eternal life and that she is now experiencing that in a new way with you. We give thanks that, like us, she ate the bread of life, drank from the cup of salvation, and gave herself in love and service to Jesus Christ. We give thanks for the many ways in which Jean shared her life with us and with others, in strength and in weakness, in achievement and failure, in the brightness of joy and the darkness of despair. We remember her as one of us. We thank you for her early life at home, her family, her beloved husband, her children, her delight in grandchildren and great-grandchildren, her commitment to working and her career as a music teacher, and above all, her commitment to her students. We thank you for her love of other things in her life, particularly animals, without which her life wouldn't be the same. We thank you for the gift of animals that blessed Jean. We thank you for her personal qualities, which we've heard so much about today. Her grace, her big smile, her love for others, her determination and willingness to fight for what she needed, her support for others no matter what standard they're at, and her dignity and courage when there were times of physical and emotional hardship. And we think particularly of those that cared for her, particularly in the later days, and we give thanks for them as well. We thank you that we are assured that nothing can separate us from your love and for the blessings that we have received through Jean's life. For all of these things, we give you thanks. We also ask for ourselves, who are feeling the loss because our love is so deep. Keep us close and allow us to share in the peace that Jean had because of you. Let us say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, yet though they die, yet they shall live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die." I know Jean claims that promise. May we all do so with her. Would you like to stand as we come to the committal? We have entrusted Jean into the hands of God. And so now we remember her body, which she's given to science, knowing that she is a blessing others, even in her death. And we thank you that her spirit is safe with you, because we can be sure and certain in hope of the resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died, was buried, and rose again for us. To God be glory forever and ever. Amen.
This little poem to end, it's called Music. Music tunes our world until our inner life has pure harmonics flair, expresses valuings for which words alone are too pinched. Valuings searching for the pulsing imaginative utterance, melody line, chord, by which signifying world can move from the realm of formless shadow into memorable form. Music is proof that persons take part in the momentum which creates worlds. Music stops and starts, darts and rests, develops, interweaves and coheres, culminates, and so do we. We too are tune. At Ken's funeral, at his request, we had this final prayer and blessing. We beseech thee, Almighty God, that we, being inspired by the example of thy saints, may run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, so that when this mortal life is ended, we may be gathered with those whom we have loved into the kingdom of thy glory, where there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away, through Jesus Christ our Lord. The choir will sing the blessing, and after that, I invite you to sit. There will be a very brief little home movie, which Jean was part of, and then refreshments in the foyer.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Whose is better? You're incorrigible.
You're hopeless.
You're my friend.
You're my friend.
Isn't it lovely?
Yeah. Yeah, we're friends really, darling.
To you, happy birthday to you, happy birthday dear Auntie Jean, happy birthday to you.
Hip hip hooray, hip hip hooray, hip hip hooray.
That's only got good one.
Well, you sprayed one out.
That's a good plan.
Now you have to make a wish.
I wish I'd come to see you often.
Mm-hmm. Well, that can come true.
Right, we'll endorse that.
You have to cut it.
Oh, to make a wish.
Yeah.
I'm a bit high up here in my perch.
You are too.
Gee, it looks nice.
Well, when now you've touched the bottom, you've got to kiss the fellow that's nearest to you.
All right.
Ah, it's Monty.
Monty, you missed that, darling.
Monty, you want to kiss?
Happy birthday, Auntie Jean.
Yeah.
You look like two billy goats. Exhausting.
It's exhausting.
Lala.
Oh, good girl. Oh, look, the tail's going.
Isn't it lovely, darling?
It is. Come on, Lala.
Oh. Oh, no.
She's human, you know, isn't she?
What's she doing with your little hat? Goodness, what are you eating Betty for? Is she a tasty morsel?
I didn't have any tomato sauce there. Nor there.
No. There must be something on your skin that she loves. Oh.
Am I going to have a visit?
Will be something Tommy, Ronnie.
Did she put any cream?
She did on my legs, but not...
Is that weird?
Oh! Yay! Look at this.
What have you got?
Chopped ginger.
Yum.
What have you got, Mum?
A cat at the moment.
It's not for you, Delilah.
Double dipped, Auntie Jean.
Hmm?
Double dipped.
Oh, you're going to turn around. Yeah, I understand.
Right. I'll run over you.
You run over my little dog, there'll be trouble.
Oh, Glory, here she comes.
Here
we
are. There we are. Oh, sorry. I better than you knocked off the chair.
I'm still there.
Are you?
Yes, and I am down there.
Oh, I know, Do it.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. What is it about you, Mum, that Delilah loves?
I don't know.
She smells.
Oh, thank you.
He's my best buddy.
Yeah. Oh, gives a smile bit.
Oh, yeah, beautiful. Me. There we go. That's a Christmas shot. Christmas 2016.
Yep. Yes, I do. I want you to
see the old chook.
Come on,
who are you calling?
Like,
do you know what she said to me? Smile, you silly old chook.
And did you say I'm not old?
Well, I said it wasn't me.
I forgot the knife. Can you grab a knife?
Ready?
You got me lined up?
Yeah. Set. Blow. Oh, good. More. A little bit more. Oh, Ray. She's done it.
move.
Maybe so.
That's
smart.
She's a star.
You won't hold your champers.
You're going to blow it out and make a wish?
And hold the knife for her.
You're right.
All right. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear mother. Happy birthday to you, born so beautiful. Why was she born at all?
She had no say in it. No say in it at all.
Hip hip hooray! Hip hip hooray! Hip hip hooray!
Hooray!
Yeah, and blow the candles.
Make a wish.
They said your lungs were good. Come on.
Blow.
One more cold.
Bad.
She's gonna wear that cake.
Go, Bert.
Don't spit on it.
Keep going. Keep going.
Go, Bert.
Come on,
you can do it. A bit of chaos in our lives. Happy birthday.
Yes, it is.
She's happy.
Yeah.
Go on, Kirsty.
Bonus.
You going to make a wish? Oh, cut it, make yes. a wish, Mum?
Oh, no, it's
make a wish.
Yeah, you've got to.
Yes, put it, the knife in.
Put the knife in, says Norm.
I haven't gone to
my dad.
Don't
touch the
bonnet. All right.
What's that window?
Yeah, reflected in
your room. New note in the prison.
Worth the drive down, Auntie Jean?
Well, worth the drive down.
I couldn't do it all on
it's
my
another
own.
One like the other one.
It's got a, like...
It's like being a kid again, isn't
it? It's just wonderful.
I don't know where your advice is. You're not meant to open the presents.
I need the knife
again. You didn't want it last time, though.
No, but you put all the butter on it.
Jesus.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I hear babies cry. I watch them grow. They learn much more than I ever knew. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Face down so my double chin doesn't show. No, it's got to go up, that's right. You see my double chin?
No, I can't. I'm taking a video of this. I can hear everything you're saying.
Oh!
All right, Delilah, why is your tail not wagging in the new chair?
Come on. Waggle, waggle, waggle. Waggle, 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 waggle.
Oh, it's a great chair. Do you want to show us what it does?
Oh, not at all, but I can. Oh, yes, I can. Wait a minute, though. Delilah. Stay.
She left, Mum. That's very good.
Now, wait, no, do the other way.
This has got a double function.
Oh, look at this.
Awesome.
I don't want to go back any further.
Come on, up you come. Oh, that's great. Yeah, Delilah, are you going to go back on a lap or not? All right, I'm going to take a photo now, okay?
Wait a minute.
Okay.
Come on, Lala. Come on. Oh, look at that. A lovely new chair we've got. Look at that lovely new chair.
What a pair you are. That's just lovely, Mum.
What does that one do?
It's recording a...
Okay, so...
No. You're mad. Both of you, stop it, Kirsty. Stop it. I'm too old.